everyone, I am Apeksha and I welcome you back to TMR Talks. Today we are going to talk about the largest pharma sector IPO which is going to hit the Indian stock markets. So we have Gland Pharmaceuticals which has a plan to raise ₹6,479 crores from the market. So this company is into generic injectables. Now let us first understand what is a generic drug. So typically what happens is a pharma company does the research, the R&D. For a particular product, and after certain pharmaceutical formulations, a final medicinal product will be launched. Now, this company will have the patent for that product. And once it comes to an end, that is after 20 years, any other company can use that formulation and produce the drug. So, the drug that would be made after the patent is expired by any other company is actually termed as a generic drug. Now, this generic drug, it must work the same way in your body and produce the similar kind of results as the brand name drug does. Okay, and one more obvious thing is that they have to first get the nod from the regulator and then only they can go ahead and produce that drug. And I think the meaning of injectable is pretty clear to you after watching these images. So it basically is something which has a capacity of being, you know, injected in your body. So that is what generic injectable means, and that is what the company does. So, the company was incorporated in the year 1978 in Hyderabad, and they are having total 7 manufacturing facilities. Now, out of these 7, 3 manufacturing facilities are for API, active pharmaceutical ingredients. So, this is very interesting. They have 3 facilities for that. And our company has expanded from liquid parenterals to now into injectable value chain, contract development, technology transfer, manufacturing across a range of delivery systems. So we will talk a little more about this as we move further. As of now, have a look at this product portfolio. So there are total 14 different categories into which the company is there. And here is the global generic injectable market. So if you observe this clearly, the anti-infective thing has a total 35% chunk. Okay, in the global generic market, and our company under the product portfolio, they were also into anti-infectives. They had certain molecules in that, and they are actually intending further, they are planning to enhance their products and to offer more and more products into this growing market. Here is the geographical presence. So if we look at the breakup, we can understand that United States is where the majority of chunk of revenue comes from, which is around about 66%, and Indian is around 17%, right? So they have a presence in total 60 different countries, and they are looking forward to penetrating mainly in the USA and Chinese markets. Now, when I talk about China, it accounts for approximately 11% of global injectable market. And talking about USA's injectable market, in the past 5 years, okay, products worth $30 billion have gone off patent. And in the coming 5 years, in the next 5 years, products worth $60 billion will be going off patent. So you can understand how big the opportunity is, the growth opportunity in this market is. And here are certain ANDA filings that the company has done. So ANDA is your abbreviated new drug application. So it is it basically contains the data which is submitted to the FDA for the review and approval of this generic products. So at the moment there are total 267 that they have filed, out of which 215 have been approved by the FDA, and there are 52 pending. Now, according to the MD of the company, what he was saying is, once the product goes off patent, immediately on the next day, they usually plan to launch the product. So it is very interesting. So they are constantly on a lookout for the products which will be going off patent, and they already start the procedure of these ANDA filings and production, etc. Now let's talk about the business model. So we saw that USA is the market through which majority of their revenue is coming, and India is around 17%. So this is how their business model is. It is into two parts, which is B2B and B2C. So again, B2B is the majority, majority revenue is coming from B2B. Now let's try to understand into B2B, what exactly do they do? So under this, they partner with some leading pharmaceutical companies in other countries, right? Which is strong and which is independent, and they have a very robust sales and distribution network. So there are 2-3 ways in which they do it. So under IP-led model, they actually adopt this model for marketing their product to some other marketing partners. Under the second one, which is B2B technology transfer, here the product is partially made by the partner company, and then eventually the technology is transferred for our company for further testing and packaging of it. Under contract manufacturing, they just give fill and finish services for the product which is already approved by other companies. So here they basically get payment for manufacturing and packaging of that product. So these are the ways in which they get licensing fees, product and packaging fees or royalties, etc. And under the B2C model, which is mainly for India. So B2B is for rest of the world, and B2C is for India, where they have a dedicated sales team. And they are further planning to improve these sales team and, the penetration and the requirement in India as well. Now, regulatory compliance. So for pharma companies, regulatory compliance is something which is a major concern, and that can be the major hurdle or the risk factor as well. Because they have to follow, this particular company has to follow the rules and regulations of US FDA, since majority of their revenue comes from them. But they have a clean record, right? So this is one of the plus points for the company, that they do not have any issues. They do not have any warning letter as it is mentioned in this PPT. Now, talking about a few other risk factors. Now, I already told you that there are three API facilities that they are having. But in spite of that, they obviously require certain other APIs which they import or they take from other suppliers. So sometimes there might be some disruption in this API supply, because if the vendor gets some warning letter from US FDA, then they will have to look for an alternative. Second of all, total 33% of their raw material as of now, as of FY 2020, was coming from China. So that is also a little risky factor in case if our relations with China worsen, or in case the import duties are increased, then their margins might hit, and they will have to again look for an alternative, a better alternative, so to say. Coming to the financials. So here is the revenue and PAT. So revenue has grown by a CAGR of 27%, and profits have grown at a CAGR of 55% in the last three financial years. And the margins are also at a good level. They are in fact improving, but the company has not given any information with respect to the dividend. So they have not even given the dividend in the last 3 years. Okay. And here is the main part, which is the research and development cost, right? So the research and development cost is actually less for this company. Now, why it is less is because they are into generic manufacturing. So they do not develop any medicine from scratch, right? They do not have to perform lengthy and costly studies, because that is already done by the brand manufacturers. So that is why they get two advantages. One is that their research and development expense is lesser. Second of all, they can afford to give the products at a little lower prices compared to the brand name drugs. So that's the case here. So talking about ROE and ROCE, ROE is also at a good level, and ROCE is actually pretty similar to ROE, because they do not have any debt as such. The debt is at a very negligible level. Here is the EPS and PE. Now talking about PE, the company is actually not having a listed peer in India. But if we consider the pharma industry's PE, which is around 36, then we can say that our PE is also at a good level. It's not too costly. But we have done a short peer comparison over here by considering a few companies which were mentioned in the RHP, and they had mentioned that these are the close competitors to this company. So from that, what we understand is now the PE is actually ranging right from 30 to 70 and 80. So that is why we have taken certain other parameters as well, such as EBITDA margin, PAT margin. If you look at this, we can see that Gland Pharma has good EBITDA as well as PAT margin as compared to the other players. And finally, here are our offer details, right? So the offer will start on 9th November. It is there till 11th. And the company plans to raise total 6,479 crores, out of which 1,250 is fresh issue, and the rest of it is offer for sale. So now what is the objective of the company? So what do they intend to do? So there are two things. One is that they are intending to raise capital for working capital, and secondly for capital expenditure, and this is how the net proceeds would be utilized as mentioned in this table. And the promoter holding is going to go down from 74% to 58%. Now coming to the next big question, which is the final take. So what do we do now? We have understood a lot about the company and what they do, etc. So see, first of all, since the company has a Chinese promoter, obviously there are anti-China sentiments in the market. But what we have done here is we have majorly focused on the business model and the generic injectable market overall. Importantly, the injectable manufacturers, they face high entry barrier. This is a business which has high capital investment, high operational cost, manufacturing complexities, etc. In fact, the injectable plant actually requires 1.3 to 1.4 times, 5 times more capital as compared to the other solid plants. So that is a big plus point for the company, right? Secondly, strategically also they are planning to penetrate in US and Chinese market. They are looking forward to increasing their product portfolio. They have a clean track record, which is important for any pharma company, and they are constantly filing the ANDAs with the FDA. And the main important point is that they are having strong financials as well. So according to us, in the long run, it is going to be a good investment opportunity. And supposedly, if India's relations worsen with China further, and if a situation comes where the parent company may not be able to operate properly in the Indian markets, then in case if there is some M&A happening, because of that reason, if there is some merger and acquisition happening, then too the company will get a good holding because they are pretty strong on all the levels as we spoke. Right, so that is why we think it is a good opportunity. You can go ahead. So guys, if you haven't subscribed already to our channel, do subscribe. We keep coming up with videos related to financial analysis, economic analysis, etc. If you have any questions, queries, comments, or your suggestions with respect to this video, do share it with me, and thank you so much.